questions in that way. How did you get on with the sisters of mercy? Do you think you've sort of some of their successes rubbed off on you? And have they made Yorkshire a great place to be for a band and all the rest of it?
Yeah.
I mean, half the questions in it were about that.
You do seem that, well, you've got the stage now where you can do two nights at the Lyceum.
Yeah.
What do you sort of put that success down to?
Sort of, although a lot of people won't see it as such, it's like just sticking to like pleasing ourselves.
Yeah.
I mean, most people look and see that we signed the Warners and think, oh no, it's all Warners, you know, sort of influence now.
Yeah.
And it's not really, I mean, we still do exactly what we want, really.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just that we've timed like the signing of that to a time when we started writing slightly different songs and wanted to do slightly different things.
Yeah.
So it's all worked together well.
Yeah.
I mean, we realised a while back that the songs were getting a little bit straighter, if you like,
yeah,
music. And so, I mean, it seemed logical to move to a record company that I like.
Yeah. You've also always gigged a lot, haven't you?
Yeah, that's true. I mean, not in comparison with some people, but certainly that helps.
Yeah.
There is quite a strong following whenever we play.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we work quite a lot.
Yeah.
I mean, we haven't got anything to go on really because we've never been in other bands, but Wayne came from Dead or Alive and he said, you know, they didn't do anything.
Yeah.
Just went out and bought a pair of trousers every now and again, and that was what being in the band was to them.
Yeah.
They didn't gig, they didn't, you know, demo any new songs, didn't do anything.
Do you think it's taken you a long time though to get where you are?
Yeah, but it's sort of very solid now. It's like everything that we're ever likely to do probably has been sort of previewed in some way. Like there's the Reptile House, which sort of suggests that we might do something like that again in the future. You know, that sort of darker, more mysterious, sort of the opposite to what is, you know, like the LP, which is very accessible and boppy and, you know, that sort of thing. I mean, it's just all the different types of things we're likely to do. People have seen it. And so I think they feel they can trust us and buy the next record because they're not going to get something that's, you know, suddenly we've got a celestial choir or something.
Yeah. This dark and mysterious song, the image has always betrayed that, and the videos always suggest that.
I mean, part of this is, to me, it's quite the opposite of what people imagine it is. I mean, to me, half of the mystery is to do with the fact that it doesn't matter that it's us.
Yeah.
I mean, until the LP, there was never a picture of us on the record sleeves.
Yeah.
And that wasn't, you know, although it was like fun to be sort of make this mystery about the group, it was also saying it doesn't matter that it's us.
Yeah.
Because we weren't anything, we weren't classically trained musicians or anything. We just, you know, started this band, and it could have been you, it could have been anybody, it doesn't make any difference.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the same thing like the Dry Ice. But that's part of it. The other part of it is it's good fun,
yeah,
to run around in a load of dry ice.
So you like using this sort of rock and roll,
yeah,
cliches?
Yeah. And also if it makes for something better to watch.
Yeah.
I mean, all the things combined, it's we tend to do it that way. I mean, you can look at something that's it's sort of very obviously using something that's gone before.
Yeah.
And it sort of gives you a better idea of, you know, what the group's about, I think. And if we didn't try to do something that wouldn't be, you know, sort of understood until 10 years' time,
yeah,
which I think is a good point.
I think you live the myth of sex, drugs and rock and roll?
Two out of three. And I shan't comment on much.
Watch him.
Most of the other boys manage all three. Some
I was reading about the album. Was it you wrote one side and Wayne wrote the other side?
It's not quite as simple as that, and even if it was that, it'd still be a bit misleading, but that's sort of a rough...
Yeah.
I mean, when we say... I mean, our version of writing songs is not the same as everybody else's.
Yeah.
I mean, Andy wrote all the words.
Yeah.
And when it says that Wayne wrote the music or I wrote the music, it means that the initial idea for the music was that person's. It doesn't mean that they said, you play that, you play that, you play that. So, I mean, all the songs are group songs, although...
Are there sort of contrasting styles?
Yeah, very much so. I mean, it just is the way that we put the LP out, you know, the track listing, that it worked out that way. And the way that the difference actually sounds is that the side which are Wayne songs are the sort of more immediate songs, the singly type songs, if you like. The other side's the what I would describe it as the side that you sort of hear things more the more you listen to it.
Yeah.
You know, it's sort of the slower side, the side that, you know, you might play the first one all the time for the first month, and then after that you'll start thinking, oh, that sort of grows on you. The criticisms that there have been of, you know, like the only person that's reviewed it and pointed out that there were totally different sides, criticised it mainly for the production and the fact that they didn't think the voice was quite as integrated into the songs on the second side, which I think is, I'd accept that.
Yeah. But
that's not really my fault.
Were you so pleased with the album then, or?
Well, it comes in patches. I'm pleased, you know, you're not one week you're pleased with it, and then the next week, you know, it's like I had amphetamine logic last night, and over the PA and it sounded absolutely horrendous, and I just wanted to get out of there. But, you know.
But people in bands are always so critical of themselves anyway, too.
Yeah, I mean, but the other thing is that to most people that's just a record that arrives with, you know, 10 songs on or whatever, and they don't think that, you know, perhaps one of those songs has been around for 18 months and has been, you know, had 15 different titles in that time, and, you know, this has changed and that has changed, and they just see it as one complete thing, and that's, they've never had any vision of it any other way, whereas to me, like, certain songs have come out different to what I first imagined them.
Yeah.
I mean, some are better for that. I mean, I would think that Some Kind of Stranger is the best example of a song that's sort of come out totally the opposite of what I thought it was when I started writing. Because a song like that is it's Andy's big woman song. You know, it's his I Want Every Woman in the World song. You know, it's that sort of song. And I wrote it from totally the opposite standpoint when I wrote the music.
Yeah.
It was like, it was my version of the wedding march. It was like a really lasting relationship song. You know, it's very strong. So it works well because it's like, it's quite emotional, and it sort of, to me, it tugs between the two. Because it's like one person saying, I want every woman in the world, and there's someone else saying, oh, but, you know, when it boils down to it, you know, when you're on your deathbed, there'll only be one that you want to see, sort of thing. And that's, I mean, it makes it really emotional to you.
Yeah.
Well, it makes it quite emotional to other people, because they think, oh, I'd like all the women in the world as well.
Well, again, the album seems to have taken a long time, but then you always had this policy of
A series of singles. It's taken a long time to actually make because of Andy's health. I mean, it took a long time for us actually to decide to make it because we sort of never had enough songs that we didn't want to use as singles.
Yeah.
You know, we were always quite happy to do that as well, just to bring out a single.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there was no real need to bring European. Everybody said, you know, why don't we bring European? They just didn't see any point to do it until we had the material and the resources to do it properly. Yeah. I mean, we've brought out about two or three albums worth of material on singles and 12 inches already.
Yeah. What was wrong with Andy's health then?
He just sort of pushed himself too hard and collapsed through exhaustion.
Yeah.
I mean, he got to a point where a lot of the backing was recorded, and he hadn't written lyrics or something.
Yeah.
And because of the schedule, he had to. He was like staying up every night to try and catch up and write the lyrics and sing and the rest of it, and he just. Like stayed up too many nights in a row. Found he couldn't stay up again. But I mean, there were more things to it than that, but it was basically just total exhaustion.
Mm. What did WA like as a record company?
Yeah, very good. No, they're all right. I'm actually quite surprised, quite pleasantly surprised. I mean, it is largely due to the fact that they do quite trust us.
Yeah.
And they have to believe that the stuff, you know, is like they've got us at our best time, if you like.
Mm.
I mean, all the stuff is sort of quite accessible, and the only thing that they sort of worry about is the fact that they like us to mix it in such a way they can hear Andy's voice.
Yeah.
I mean, where in the past it wasn't, you know, particularly mixed with that in mind.
Yeah.
I mean, just because of the fact that we're going to get played on the radio a lot, and they won't play it if they can't hear it singing about it. But I mean, it was at a time when, you know.
They were the one company who were after you for ages, weren't they?
They sort of. Yeah, they were interested, and they went off. I think it was about the time of the Reptile House that they decided they didn't want us anymore. And then, of course, when Temple of Love came out, it was boys, come here. Let me talk to you. No, I think they're like, you know, just to see us. I think they probably doubted that we could do another sort of zippy single when we brought the Reptile on. Because I mean, it was like Alice that started everybody's attention. Because I mean, that is still quite, to me, quite a commercial sounding song.
Yeah.
Although we'll never re-release it or anything like that. And yeah, that was like the one that got everybody interested. Then we followed that up by being going the opposite way and doing the Reptiles. Just because it was like something to get out of the way, because we all wanted to make that sort of a record sooner or later. We might as well have done it then.
Yeah. Is the single in the charts now?
It might just be in the top 75, I don't know.
I was under the impression it was in the charts.
It went in at 63, stayed at 63 the next week, and this week I've not actually seen the Gallup chart. I've seen another chart which says it's at 50-something, but I think it's a network chart, so...
Yeah.
I can't imagine it's gone. It's just a fact that it's on the LP.
Yeah.
So people buying the LP. I mean, the LP's didn't, right? 14.
Yeah. When I first heard the single, I was a bit sort of unsure about it because I just went out and bought it. And then it just grows on you.
Yeah, it's not. I mean, that's why it's not got very far, because it's not. Although it's a good song, it's not immediate enough for, you know, a DJ to hear it and think, oh yeah, I'll play that, definitely.
Yeah.
No, it's not one that you can make your mind up about instantly, I think.
Yeah.
Well, you can, but if you do, you'll say it's crap. Well, there were quite a lot of sort of different choices, and we were in two minds whether to release that, or First and Last and Always, or Black Planet, or Rock and a Hard Place as a single.
Yeah.
It was just, we went for that because it was like a favourite, you know, we'd done it on the last tour and it seemed to go down well.
You got into the video world now, what, do you think that's a good thing?
No. it's alright, I mean, it's just a very, It's just a very tedious thing to actually do.
Oh, making a video.
Yeah. And it really is very, very boring. I mean, I could imagine if, in a year's time, we can sort of get more involved in it. You know, actually, if we actually have some sort of know-how and can say, right, we'll direct it.
Yeah.
I could imagine it'd be quite good fun then, but at the moment it's just about 2 hours waiting for him to set something up, to get it all set up, this particular lighting situation and everything.
Yeah.
Film it, which takes about a minute, then you go and sit down again. I mean, everything's just so slow.
Yeah.
I mean, the actual finished things were like, I mean, I like seeing them on TV.
Yeah.
It's certainly a lot better than seeing most people on TV. And like the video for No Time to Cry is on my.
Yeah, I saw it on the TV. I was hoping it was going to on the whistle test when they.
Yeah, the video votes.
And the video vote.
I don't know anyone that actually got through to that.
Yeah.
I spoke to loads of people and said they could not get through.
I thought, it's got to be Sisters of the Damned. It's got to be one of our.
Well, the Damned one looked quite good. I was hoping it was going to be the Damned.
But I saw it on the tube then, but I didn't have my video. I just got in from work, so I couldn't actually video it. That's the trouble with single videos. I mean, unless can't get hold of them. Would you ever do a full length video?
Well, having said what I've just
said. No, but I'd say live or something.
Yeah, a live one possibly. I mean, there is a live one coming out, which is. It's a cheap one. I mean, it's not going to be anything like, you know, the Cult of Dreamtime or anything.
Yeah.
It's just a friend of ours with two cameras at a couple of dates on the body and soul turn. I mean, they were. They weren't particularly exciting gigs, but you know, to some people it'll be a worthwhile sort of artifact. I haven't seen the finished thing. I mean, you can actually make things look quite interesting with two cameras, even if they
were. I've seen some bloke did that with a cult at one gig where he did it himself, and I've seen parts of that, and he sort of dropped things in, you know, and slides in front of the as he's filming them.
Well, I've seen. When we used to be sort of involved with the psychedelic fairs, someone, just like a fan, had made a video for, what was it? We Love You, the first single.
Yeah.
I mean, just done it himself, you know, with just old, I don't know how it got old, all the footage. It was, it might have just taped one of their videos for something else, so it was the odd shot of them, but it was mostly just, like all the, you know, like it goes, I'm in love with so-and-so. And it was like all those bits, and it was really good. I mean, they were, you know, it was better than any of their videos that they'd had done for thousands of pounds.
Yeah. Yeah, I think a cult video is quite good.
Not that I've not seen it.
But, could have been better, I suppose.
Yeah, no, I mean, they're a good live band.
Yeah. What about, have you got any new cover versions?
I don't know, what are you up to date with? You've seen us do Knocking on Heaven's Door? We've done that a few times this tour. We did Stairway to Heaven. Somewhere. Just the once.
Yeah.
We got about two verses into it and Andy said, etc. Because he couldn't remember anymore, so that was. I don't think we'll do that again. There isn't like an epic cover at the moment.
No.
We're still doing it.
Will that ever be committed to vinyl?
I don't know. There's a lot of pressure to. Not from the English record company, from the American record company.
Yeah.
They really want us to do it. But I mean, they seem as if they've sort of resigned themselves to the fact that we won't. So.
Yeah.
I think we'll get. I mean, we don't want to do it.
Yeah.
I mean, to us, it's a very special thing, and that's. That's probably the song which is best for summing up what we're like live, I think.
Yeah.
And that's the sort of emotion that we hope it generates when we play.
Yeah. How popular are you in America?
We don't sell many records there.
Yeah.
But up until now you've had to import them, and we haven't had anything distributed through the major record company there, except the LP.
Yeah.
But we've got a sort of... a lot of people in the college radio thing that's over there which is very strong. So I mean, we get a lot of airplay by that,
yeah.
And we get all these charts and booth back, and we're like, you know, well up in those. And actually, in the more, I don't want to call them fashion conscious, but I can't think of anything else to call them. The other places that are more in touch with what's happening in England, like New York and the West Coast, I mean, they go down really well there, because they want to see us. You know, it's like, oh, this is nice. Yeah, I read about them. They're one of England's number one cult bands, aren't they?
Yeah. And what about Europe now?
Europe's alright. I mean, everywhere in Europe is okay. I mean, it's just that some of the European countries aren't that. They're so different in their response to gigs that it's hard to tell if they like you or not. I mean, in Holland, they're so. I mean, it's like all the hippies and all that over there, and it's just, they're so lethargic. I mean, if they can be bothered to clap at the end of the set, you know, they've done well. You know, and that's like a really good reception. You, we're not going to play an encore for those wankers. What are you on about? And they go, you've gone down really well. You go, Belgium's good. I mean, Belgium, we're almost like teeny bop stars in Belgium for some reason. I don't know what it is. Just because I suppose the size of the place and some sort of bad information they've been getting. You know, I could imagine that one person, you know, on the radio can sort of control Belgium. And, this is, you know, the number one in England or something, and don't believe it. Yeah.
So, the single I haven't got into the lower reaches, possibly the next one will get into the charts. How do you see sort of fitting into the pop market?
Well, I suppose that'll depend on what we do as the next single. I mean, we are thinking of doing anything more off the LP, so it'll have to be a new song, which at the moment doesn't exist. So it's hard to say whether it'll be a chart hit or not. I can't see. It has sort of, because we've been in the LP chart and high in the LP chart, it's sort of, that rubs off. So I think the next single will do well.
Yeah.
Especially if it is something new, because that's what everybody's going to want. I mean, because we've done everything. I mean, everything that we do live or whatever is, you know, available. I mean, they're going to be looking for the new song. Is it going to be really bland and wimpy? You know, so as long as it's good, it'll do well. I mean, the last two singles got higher than this. I mean, Walk Away got to 43.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the hope is that the LP, because there are certain people that don't really buy that many singles and buy a lot of LPs, that we might sort of get into that little niche, you know, the sort of simple mindsy type people, and the U2 and Echo people and all those, you know, that, I mean, buy a lot of records.
Yeah.
And if they haven't any knowledge of what's gone before and you just get this LP, think this is good, and we bring out a single, they're likely to say, oh, I'll get that, because they're going to want, you know, more.
Why do you, a lot of the other bands that you sort of grew up with seem to have, there's not many left.
Fizzled out, haven't they?
Why do you think you've survived? Is it the music? Or?
I think it's because, in a way, like, the band was always a massive thing to us, you know, so it's like bigger than all of us, if you know what I mean. I mean, so most people, I don't think it's that important. I think there'd been like a lot of sacrifices for the band, so it was like never a question of sort of packing it in or anything, because like everything that you could fall back on and been thrown away anyway. So I mean, like, you know, personal relationships and everything. But yeah, I would say that. I mean, about the ones that I know, I mean, I don't think it was important enough to me. I don't think they're that good bands, mainly. I mean, I think the sort of cult of country was several or traumatic changes and all that. And the other bunch, it wasn't me, it was the other three, what they're getting for you. I mean, they're probably shape up all right.
Aye.
But I mean, our dad don't sort of mourn the demise of people like Sex Gang or anything like that. I think Down Society just about fizzled out.
Yeah.
And then it's if they could have done it right for a while. March Violets, I'm not really sure about. I'm told that they're rapidly becoming the new Pat Benatar. I don't know about that.
So there's the lots of bands in Leeds and that.
Leeds. A lot of bands, I mean, but none. The only band that I sort of look forward to seeing at the moment is Salvation.
Yeah.
Because I mean, we did the first single with them, and since then they've had a slight lineup change and a slight change of attitude. And as much as when they first started, they were quite sort of synthesizer orientated.
Yeah.
They've suddenly decided that they're going to get rid of those horrible synthesizers, and they've got like a new guitarist who's, you know, well run chick.
Yeah.
And they decided to, you know, bring like a real bass into it. And the whole thing's much more, you know, bollocks in it.
Yeah.
And they played the other night when we were playing in Leeds, so I missed them because that was their first gig. So I mean, I'd like to see them. I think they're, you know, going to start gigging quite soon, you know, in a big way.
I'm totally unbiased, obviously.
I mean, they're about the only band in Leeds on the up and up. You know, so.
Yeah.
I mean, there's certain bands that just restrict themselves to Leeds. And, I don't pay much attention to it. I mean, to them, you know, it's all right. I mean, to them, I imagine it's more like a hobby. Right?
Yeah.
It's obviously going to be difficult. I hope it's a good match. It's interesting to see the team
that Nash has picked. Do you get much time, though, Pat? Because with a band, like, do you get much time to do?
Much time to
other
do?
Other things.
Yeah, but because, well, you don't get a lot of time, because of the fact that you're working so much.
Yeah.
I mean, your other time, you don't really want to go and see a band.
No.
If you don't,
yeah.
You know, I go down and muck out the horses and, you know, shit like that. I'm not really interested in seeing a band.
Yeah.
And also, I mean, you want to get away from people that are talking about the band.
Mm.
I just go and see my mates and talk about something else completely. Because it can get, you know, to a point where you think, well, don't I know anyone that isn't interested in me just because I'm in the band, you know? So, I mean, the fact that you maybe get, you know, a couple of months out of every 12, you know, in total, at the odd day here, the odd day there, three,
yeah.
It doesn't give you a lot of chance to sort of say, oh, I'll go and produce this band today.
Yeah.
I'll go and check them out.
Seem to have done two long tours now. What are you going to do after this?
No tours.
You going abroad anyway?
After, yeah, we're doing this tour which finishes on the 1st of April.
Yeah.
Then we'll do the whistle test.
Yeah.
Play the whistle test on the 2nd. Have about a week in a studio somewhere. Seeing if we can write this new single, and then go to Europe for about a month, and then depending on certain things, America for about the same. There's a slight thing about when we'll do America, because they haven't actually put the record out yet. So I mean, we'll go to America, but quite well. But after that, I'll be feet up for a while.
But do you look forward to being on the road in
America? Because the dollar's looking very, very strong. Get over there. Yes. It's all right. I mean, once you've been on the road for, you know, a couple of months, all you want to do is go back in the studio. But if we don't tour for a while, I'll get an itching to do it. Well, if not touring, definitely playing. I mean, I really miss playing if we don't play for a long time.
Yeah.
And, I mean, touring's good because it's, you know, if you've got like 10 gigs in a row, you get in the swing of it. And like when you go on the first night, you know, it takes you four numbers to get into it, and then you second night it takes you two numbers to get into it, you know. By the time you've got, you know, you're well into it, you don't need to sort of get used to being on stage or anything, you just go on and it's, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, that's why London usually gets to see the best gigs. I mean, poor people in Scotland, I mean, we start every tour there, it must be horrible. So we turn up and we go, I don't know how that one goes, you know how that one goes, and like all stood there and, you know, shouting to each other on the stage, and then like, so I mean, one day we'll go up to Scotland and play a good one. I mean, they seem to like it because they haven't seen us as many times as everybody else.
Yeah.
They haven't got as much to go on. I mean, we've played so many times in London, I think, but
yeah.
If people came and saw us and we were a bit sloppy and we didn't know when to change, you know, new songs, a bit upset.
Yeah.
You haven't asked me how well it's going, have you?
Yeah, you're not looking very wealthy.
No, there's no real outward signs of superstardom there. I don't think we've ever. I mean, even. I mean, like Temple Lux sold a lot of copies, even though it was only independent.
Yeah.
And we've never given ourselves anything like that.
Yeah, it's always gone into the bank.
Yeah, and just put it back in.
Yeah.
Stupid, really. I mean, that's possibly another reason why other bands sort of don't get so far, because they sort of want something out of it straight away.
Yeah.
Rather than sort of thinking of it as an investment.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's not that hard to go around with tape on your boots for 4 years or so.
So, what's your ambition then? Personally, I mean, where do you want to see the band go? And how long do you see it going for?
Well, I'll leave the last one. I'd like to see the second LP go to number one on the LP charts, probably. Second and last in the North. Got the title already. I'd just like to see us become like an important band, like to, you know, like a couple of bands that people consider important, you know, and no one sort of scoffs at if you say we're important. I'd just like us to be in that sort of respected position, I suppose.
Yeah. And perhaps so that people can look back as on the Sisters of Mercy.
Oh, you mean immortality?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's quite. It's quite useful for us old fellas. Yeah, that'd be nice. I'm not particularly interested in dying tomorrow to become a rock legend or anything.
No.
The idea of the music being so, you know, us providing such a substantial amount of good music that we will remember for a long time. You know.
Yeah.
Yeah. A new pair of boots. So at some point,
yeah.
With gaffer tape.
Did you always sort of believe in the music that you'd get sort of this far and like you're going to carry on now?
Yeah.
When you were
but
playing
it's
about
because
we're 20
so
people.
Bloody horrible at one point that I can't imagine why, but yeah, I always have.
Yeah.
I don't know why. Yeah, I mean, there's always been like the faith in it.
Yeah.
And in a lot of ways it hasn't changed that much in the sense of when we started out, this is always how what we wanted it to be.
Mm.
And we've always sort of tried to do things that little bit out of our actual ability to do.
Yeah.
And so we've actually got here now. I mean, when we started, the songs were supposedly similar sort of songs, it's just that we couldn't play them that way. And we didn't know how to make it sound good.
Yeah.
But I mean, anybody that's sort of musical would look at the songs and say, oh, they're not that different from, you know, in terms of music.
Yeah.
You know, in actually how, like how difficult it is to play, for instance, or anything like that. I think we just sort of learn how to arrange songs a bit better. and use the studio in a way to make it a little bit more colourful. I think probably the records in the past were fairly drab in comparison, just because we didn't know much about. You know, if you put a piano on there, it'll sound quite nice. You know?
Yeah.
Even though you might think a piano is a pretty bloody ponzy thing to put on a record, it actually might sound better than, you know,
yeah,
a guitar with a fuzz box, you know, in a certain place.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, those gigs, there's a lot of people sort of to thank for having any faith in us. I mean, it's easy for us to have faith in it.
Yeah.
You know, because it's us. And it's, you know. But the other people that sort of came along and said, yeah, this is good. And still do. And they're the ones to thank. Because, I mean, if we'd turned up every time we'd played in London and, you know, we brought Alice OK, but I mean, if we turned up and played a gig in London and knowing how we sounded, they hadn't come and seen people enjoying it. They would have said, no, this band's no good. And so, I mean, those people are responsible in a way.
Well, I mean,
it's like going to see the Balm of the Angel last night. I mean, if anybody was down there going to check out the Balm of the Angel, like, it wouldn't have mattered how good they were if there weren't that 100 people at the front having a really good time jumping back.
Yeah, because but Fulham was the, because they played 4 times this week in London.
Has
it? That was the, but it was, they've only played, apart from playing with the Cult, they'd only played once in the Marquee supporting Troy Tate. And everybody turned up off the culture to see Balam. There was no one there for Troy Tate, as you can imagine. But they played the ICA and they got messed around because they were made to headline. Mm. So everyone went home, apart from the following. And then Croydon, and it was like too far out for a lot of people. And Herne Hill, everybody thinks it's in the middle of nowhere when it isn't. Well, there was quite a lot of people there. But, what I always find strange is that I remember Sisters of Mercy sporting brilliant. And our Sisters of Mercy are up there brilliant, they're still where they are. Also, the Smiths supporting Sisters of Mercy.
Well, that's quite the reverse.
And that's the reverse. And I remember seeing the Alarm supporting the Farmers boys. And it's funny how bands just.
I mean, we started off. I mean, our first gig we supported the Thompson Twins.
No.
But I don't think we're quite reached the point where that's reversed. The second or the third, it was something like the Thompson Twins, then Altered Images, and then the band that are now King. They were called the Reluctant Stereotypes, I think, at the time. So that was like our first 3 gigs. Yeah, I mean, the thing with both Brilliant and the Smiths, I was, well, not so much the Smiths, but Brilliant, it was like they were doing something that was sort of in vogue at the time. It was like, you know, everybody wants to have a funky, a cross between sort of tribal and funky, which, you know, they were there at the time, and that's why they were sort of big at that time, or bigger than us.
Yeah.
Ours is something that's sort of never been totally unfashionable or totally fashionable, or it's just sort of something that, you know, will always be a band like us, if you like, and that sort of.
Yeah.
I mean, it could have been, you know, we could have been around 6 years ago, we could be around, you know, it wouldn't make a lot of difference. It's not a fashionable thing. The Smiths, I think, their success has been sort of rapid because they've got, it was so sort of fresh and new. I mean, that in a sense has been their downfall because it's,
yeah,
because it was so sort of contrived, if you like.
Yeah, I think the market they got into.
It sort of grinds on you after a while.
There wasn't any competition there. Anyway, no. Bands like Orange Juice had disappeared, yeah, so they could just come along. Yeah. But I think the Sisters of Mercy are a rock band, aren't they? You know,
I mean, that's probably the word that,
and, you know,
that I was looking for when I said, you know,
there's nothing wrong with that.
There's nothing wrong with that if you don't, I mean, as long as you don't go in for the things that a lot of so-called rock bands go in for, you know, like the heavy metal type thing, like the attitude to like every song is about pulling boilers or on the road songs. Like AC/DC.
Yeah.
Although I quite like watching AC/DC. And most of the songs are just diabolical.
Yeah.
And giving the dog a bone and stuff like that. And as long as you can use something that's been used for other things in the past, you know, like rock music. It's cheaply been used for, you know, promoting self-abuse. As long as you can use it for something else every now and again.
Yeah.
You know, self-abuse is alright. It'd be nice to have another side to things every now and again. And as long, I mean, people seem to have sort of got to a point where they can accept that. I mean, they can accept that, you know, someone will make a pop record and it'll have a serious political point or whatever.
Yeah.
And they seem to have sort of got round to that way of thinking, you know, so they don't just look and think, oh, that sounds like that, it's got, you know, it's got to be about those sort of things.
Yeah. What are those, I've noticed, I can't remember what it says on the badges for the two.
What, Jesus Loved the Sisters?
Jesus Loved the Sisters.
Jesus Loved the Sisters, yes. People have heard that before somewhere. I keep telling you. I don't know. Jesus Loves the Stooges.
Oh, is that what I'm doing?
No, it's... I don't really know.
The thing is, there's always been this humour to the sisters that it doesn't always come through.
It doesn't come through at all. I mean, we try. We try and make it fun for ourselves, and if people latch onto it, then okay. I mean, it's not easy to get into. I mean, it's so sort of. It's not like in jokes, but it's
sad.
Yeah, I mean, you've got to have like a fair amount of knowledge as a group to get into it. I mean, we're not a joke band. We don't set out to, you know, make everybody go ha ha all the time. I mean, it's just that's part of our personality. So I mean, we put it in. Sometimes we put the serious songs, the bits that are so serious that people don't get into them.
Yeah.
And there's like a middle thing, which is like the immediate sort of layer that you get when you listen to a record.
Yeah.
Then if you want, you know, if you're quite a serious person, you'll probably probe a bit deeper and think, well, you know, why does he say this there, you know. It's like if you're into listening to words and you're like, I mean, you'll pick up more than someone who just sort of listens to the voice, and you know, if he sings in tune it's okay, you know, if he sounds alright. I mean, there's some people that don't listen to lyrics much at all, that quite like our music.
Yeah.
Which is alright. We make it for anybody.
Yeah. Seems to be, Andy seems to have a strange relationship with the music press, doesn't he? Well, more the music press making this thing out of him.
Yeah, I don't know, it's just. There are not a lot of people that Andy feels comfortable talking to in the music press.
Yeah.
And most of them want to write something about him, so there's a sort of mixture of Andy winding them up and winding and them winding him up, so
yeah.
And basically just keeps his name in the papers, so as long as it's he's not offended by anything, then it's all right.
Yeah. You got any funny stories to tell us?
Funny stories. I don't know. Well, probably. Not just that tunnel. Funny stories. No, nothing funny happened to us. thrown up a few times, but that gets pretty tedious on various people.
Are you gonna get a sick being sick in? I threw up in Preston and get me fair.
You did?
Right.
We did, God, Blackburn, I think it was. Blackburn, and we're doing Sister A, and Craig's usually quite, not introverted, but I mean, he just usually stands there on stage. So he's quite happy to stand near his amp so he can hear what he's playing and get into that. Blackburn is, we're doing Sister A, and he's really going for it. He's running about all over the place, and suddenly we sort of, it's one of those bits where we all go quiet for a bit. All the dry eyes, I lost him from it. I couldn't see where he was. Couldn't see where he was. I'm looking all over, and he starts playing again. And he's up on top of like the stack at the back. And it's all sort of slowly building up, and he's there on the top. Comes into the bit where we're all going to crash back in, and he jumps off the top of this thing to land perfectly in time, which would have been great, but because it shook him up so much when he actually dropped to the floor, he threw up. So he did this massive jump, threw up, and then started rolling around in it. So I think he'll just be stood there tonight, back to his usual position.
What do you reckon to the scientists?
I like them.
Yeah.
It's just good fun to have someone like that on the tour, I think. Yeah. Something you don't have to think about too much.
Yeah.
I mean, they just go on, they're very straightforward, they just all
make
a big noise and get off. I mean, they're very uncomplicated in every sense. I mean, they're very easy to get on with.
Yeah.
Which is good. They don't take any setting up or anything because they're not bothered what it sounds like, really. They just get on there, shake their hair, and make a glorious racket. Get their fuzz boxes on.
Yeah, I've seen them a few times in London. First time I thought, oh, yeah, this is really good, but then after a couple of times,
it's something you don't have to worry about. Though. You can just go, right.
Yeah.
And if you can't get to the bar, you go and watch a couple of numbers, and it doesn't matter if you sort of stop halfway through, because nothing different's going to happen. Like, it's just, if you like that sort of thing, you're going to have a great time.
Yeah.
I mean, I got up and watched them most nights, which I didn't do with everyone. I didn't do with Flesh for Lou, I was going to say.
Oh,
I mean, Flesh were alright, but I don't know, it wasn't the same, it wasn't as much fun to be
It's funny with them. Flesh for Lulu, because they won these bands that have been around for years in London, and I used to hate them.
Yeah.
And like when they supported you in London, I said, right, we've got to sit in the pub until we know they finished, you know. And then I went to see, I can't remember why I went to see them. I went to see them again, and I thought, God, these are really good, and I go on now.
Well,
and
I quite got into them.
Yeah, they
were all right.
Because
so.
They played
people that were all right.
They played a marquee last Sunday. It's good rock and roll.
Yeah, I mean, I've got the LP, and I don't think it's up to that much.
No.
And I don't think they did Restless very well on it either.
No.
So there, boys. Yeah. I thought there was a lot of sort of naff songs on there. They liked what presumably an LP by us would have been like if we'd made it after bringing out three singles or whatever it is they've done.
Yeah. Bands like Flesh and Dance, they don't seem to have clicked after signing to the majors.
No, that is true, yeah. I mean, Dance Society, the first single when they signed to Arista did quite well, or about 70, something like that.
Yeah.
But I think, with a sort of group like that, record company soon lose interest in them.
Yeah.
They think, well, we tried, they didn't get in the charts, Sod it, but just write them off.
Yeah.
And if a band's not particularly sort of pushy, it's quite easy to get left in that position, where no one takes any interest in. I mean, there's often cases where a band is signed usually by one person in particular who likes them.
Yeah.
I mean, they get the say-so, like the people above them, if there are any. But if that person for any reason should leave, I mean, you're sort of left with a record company who just doesn't want to work for you or with you because no one actually likes you.
Mm.
I mean, that's a very common thing. I don't know if it's happened with any of those bands, but it happens all the time.
Yeah, it seems to be a fast turnover of...
Yeah, I mean, there are so many easy ways to get sort of money out of records now, you know, just by thinking, right, have we got a band like U2? No. Well, go and get one cheap somewhere. Go and find one.
Mm.
And everybody can make sort of one single that sounds, you know, in that sort of style, or in the Howard Jones style, or whatever style they think, you know, is going to be all right that particular week,
yeah,
and make some money out of it, rather than having to plough money into something like Dance Society, which, to be sort of fair to him, ain't going to break in a big way ever, I don't think, because I don't think his voice is that sort of strong.
Thing is, the record companies are always trying to create things, but I just think they should, instead of trying to break bands in a big way, accept that they're only going to appeal to such a market. Yeah. Surely if you invest so much, if you can get it.
Yeah, I mean, WA seem to be quite happy with that, not with us, because I think they put more money in us than most people.
Yeah.
The sort of blank, what's it called, Blanco Y Negra, something.
Oh, yeah.
That little set with the Screaming Blue Messiahs and Jesus and Mary Chain and all that, which, you know, obviously they haven't got that. And the Screaming Blue Messiahs for, you know, because they think they're going to be a mega band. I don't think, you know, it's just somebody there likes it, thinks there's a market for it. It might be a bit limited, but they're quite prepared to, you know, give work to people to do that, and, you know, keep something going.
I think that's what companies need to do more, because it's such a mess, all these bands being hyped, and they waste so much money.
Yeah.
But the sad thing is, there's still the radio airplay in this country.
Yeah, so it's all tied up. You've got to play this, you can't play that. There's very little room for anybody. If there was a DJ with any sort of individuality, or, you know, to come through and play what he wanted.
Yeah.
I mean, it's all this thing now, and the radio is just like everybody's got to be a personality, but none of them have got a personality worth speaking. Like, you know, so it's just hideous.
Yeah.
And they all play the same dress. Mm. And you can tell they all come from the same sort of school of thought. You know, they're all sort of hippies at heart, if you like. They all play the charts, and if they play anything that isn't in the charts, it's something fucking horrible from 1973. You know, by Jackson Brown or something. Or the Eagles.
Because a lot of people, I know, because the people in work think I'm sort of some kind of nutcase who goes on talking about bands I've never heard of. And I keep saying, look, if you'd sort of actually heard these bands, you'd like them. It's just you're not exposed to them. And then when they do hear them, they sort of realise.
To a lot of people, the fact that independent chart doesn't exist.
Yeah.
No idea about any of that stuff.
Yeah.
Which is, I mean, it's stupid because, I mean, there are a lot of quite poppy groups in there.
Yeah.
But it's not just about, you know, being weird and alternative.
That's right, yeah.
It's about people, you know, doing things on a fairly limited budget and doing it as best they can. Hopefully, I mean, at its best. I mean, some people just sort of wallow in that attitude that, you know, we're independent, we're going to make a horrible bloody noise, you know, because, you know, we're going to be really sloppy and horrible.
Mm.
And there's quite a lot of, you know, good things coming out of the independent thing, but I mean, they always seem to look to sign pretty early, which often sort of messes it up a bit. But I think Red Rhino have got some good stuff at the moment. Scout the Family and Red Lorry and that.
Yeah.
And they, you know, they were always like behind us, and they've got quite a good track
record. And they've got they set up Chainsaw for living in Texas,
yeah,
didn't they?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not wild about living in Texas.
I really like them. Right.
I went to see him once, so quite amusing to watch. Guitarist, really funny. It's like Northern Vista.
Yeah, they're playing tonight. There's a Fire on Ice and Geschlecht Act.
Was that?
That's in the calendar upstairs.
Was that the club foot?
Yeah, they're knocking that place down soon. Mm.
So that'll be John Kerr again, is it?
Yeah. I presume it's... No, it's not, actually.
He stopped doing it.
Clubfoot doesn't... He does a one-off set on a, like, last night playing Jane with someone, but tonight it's being done by... Because Geschlecht wrote to me asking if I wanted to go, but I don't. Being set up by some new organisation trying to help bands in London. So, I don't know.
I'm going to have to...
Okay. Well, is there any more you want to? I think we've got enough, right?
Well, I'm going to see them tomorrow if you want to talk, if I've got anything to say, I can't think of anything.